Yeah, I did notice this. Kudos on her for making it through. I'm recording the rest. Yep. Okay, great. Let's launch into things. That took a fair amount of time and a little bit worried about getting through the content for the night. Well, it's good. I really enjoyed everyone's projects. We're going to go from here on the course. We've been talking about a lot of the motivation behind website design. We're going to dive down pretty quickly here in the next couple days, a couple classes, and get at the nuts and bolts of building websites. Want to share a couple resources. One is JS Fiddle. This is an online site to do JavaScript programming in a way you can share links and send them back and forth to each other. I'm going to show some examples in JS Fiddle. For the most part, I'm going to be having you guys work in GitHub and putting your sites up on a server. You'll see a lot of examples I show in class in JS Fiddle, and feel free to, if you have a problem, put it into a Fiddle to send it back to me rather than necessarily having me have to set up your website to see a problem you're working on. It's way easier when you're sending me issues and problems you're hitting to have them in something that I can run. And so that's the main purpose of JS Fiddle, is to have something you can share back and forth very easily with. The other thing I've got on this page that I want to point out right now, y'all are going to be using this dev tools, and I use Chrome developer tools, but all of the different browsers have them. For the most part, I'm going to talk about Chrome, though. F12 on Windows or Command Option I on a Mac will bring up the side panel on any website that gives you access to the developer console, so the console messages, and also to a lot of development information about the website. If ever you're having a problem, you're having errors in your website or something, the first question I'm going to ask is, what does this say in the developer's console? Make sure you know where that is. There used to be a real dictum that HTML and JavaScript are a separation of code and data. And we're starting to see some of that go away, and things like JSX and React are merging code and data more. Conceptually at this point in learning how to code, still keep them separate. We're going to talk a little bit tonight about what JavaScript is, but then next class go way deeper into it. JavaScript is your programming language, and basically how you're doing all of the conditional actions on your web page. And that's separate than your display. And so display and code are different. Let me show an example of this. Except it'll pop up, of course, on the screen you can't see. No? Oh, there we go. Excellent. Okay, so this is JS Fiddle, and so again, you'll be doing some exercises in here. The HTML in this is really very easy. So we talked some about tags last week. I've got this H1 tag or a heading tag, and in JS Fiddle, the way it's set up, there are four panes. There's the HTML pane, the CSS pane, and the JavaScript pane, and then the output window. And so this H1 tag is making that JavaScript example number 2 appear very big, just because heading 1 is naturally given a larger size. In one of the later exercises today, we'll talk about CSS and how you could actually control what that heading looks like. Then we've got an input field, that's where you type, and we've got a button here. Now, to make that button do anything, you have to jump into JavaScript. Let me type something here, and then press my button, and it's going to change that heading to something. The way that it changed that heading to something was through this JavaScript code. And so in the HTML, in this input, I've said it has a value of change. The onClick is change with two parentheses after it. Anytime you see something with a pair of parentheses after it, whether there's anything in those parentheses or not, it means that what you're doing is calling a JavaScript function. And we'll talk about how you write JavaScript functions here as we go on, the JavaScript function in this case is this function change. The first thing it's doing is going, I'm gonna grab a variable. A variable is something that is basically a slot you can store something in. And in JavaScript, a variable can be anything. It can be a number, it can be a piece of text, it can be a date, it can be a time. Anything you want can fill one of these variables. Just think of it as an arbitrary envelope, an arbitrary slot. So I'm naming a variable, my new title, and then I am talking to what's called the document object model. The document object model is what underlies all web pages, and it's this hierarchical model of the elements on a page. And so in this case, I'm saying, talk to the document, get an element that is my text field, and my text field is what I gave as the ID of that input field. So that my text field is whatever I'm writing in here. And then take the value of that field. So in this case, something. Here we've got an if statement. An if is an example of a conditional branching. And it's really only in code, only in JavaScript, that you can do this type of conditional branching. And so what I'm saying is that if the length of my new title, which I've just gotten out of the document object model, is 0, then I'm going to pop up a dialog saying, type some real text, please. That means that if I hadn't put anything into that box and I press change, it's going to give me this alert saying, type some real text. If I don't, it's going to not do that. If it's greater than 0, if there's something in there, then it's not going to fall into that conditional, and it's instead going to drop out to the end of this, creating another variable called title. And this title variable, I'm setting to the title that's up here. And then title.innerHTML. InnerHTML is a special piece in the document object model that consists of the HTML for an element. And so the HTML of that title is what we're setting to my new title, which is what we grab from that text entry field. So when I press change, we'll see that line change that title to XX in this case. It's a walk through a fairly simple program interacting between HTML and JavaScript. And we'll go through a bunch of examples of different types of JavaScript interaction. When you're working with a new concept, JS Fiddle is often a really convenient place to come do it for the first time, though. Let me pop back to there. There are some differences between JS Fiddle and the web pages that you'll have on your site, though. We've been talking a lot about GitHub, a lot about a web server coming up in a few minutes. When you're doing that, you'll actually have a couple elements that do not appear in JS Fiddle. So just copying the code out of JS Fiddle into your individual files on a web page will not work. The main thing that's missing is that usually in your web page, you'll have to explicitly load CSS files. So you'll use this link rel equals style sheet type equals CSS, and then the name of your CSS file. And you'll have to put that in when you convert something from a JS Fiddle page to a standard web page on your web server. The second is that JavaScript just kind of runs magically next to your code in JS Fiddle. Normally, you'll have to include it either within a script tag or within another JS file. And so let me go to another example that shows this one. This is basically the same example that I had up here. If I type something in here, it's going to update that just the way that it was. I've only changed it by adding one line. And this is inside the script tag in the HTML. I've actually got JavaScript now. And you think, by the way, you have these panes organized, that's a weird thing to do. And it kind of is a weird thing to do, but you can actually put script anywhere in an HTML tag, as long as you are in an HTML page, as long as you enclose it within this script tag. What I'm actually doing in this script is calling console log with just a random text string foo. In order to see that, I would actually open up my developer console. And let me open that pane on the side up. And I'll clear what was up there, and I'll run that again. And you'll see it'll print out foo. And that is because of this console log output line. If that was bar instead, I run that again, I'll see it print bar. And so one of the reasons I point this out is that console log is one of your best friends when you're writing JavaScript code. That anywhere you're not sure what a value of a variable is, anywhere you're not sure if it's getting into an if statement, anywhere you're not sure what it's doing, put a console log in there and get it to spit out some text saying what it's doing. And then you'll have to go to that developer console in order to see that text come back out. Flying through things, I've talked a little bit about this, but a programming language is something with variables, with APIs. These are things. Console log is basically an API. Yeah, you've got a console object, and it has a log function you can call on it. API stands for Application Programming Interface, but really just think of it as something that exposes functions. A programming language is something that has control flow, like if, then, or while, or switch statements. These are all ways of doing conditional branching within a program. And it's something that has objects and methods involved. JavaScript specifically is an object-oriented programming language, meaning that everything you see in JavaScript is an object, and it has methods associated with those objects. There's another way of doing programming languages called functional programming. There you really don't have this idea of objects or methods attached to objects. You have this idea of functions, things that are chained. And so you have these long function chains. You also use recursion a lot in functional programming. We may do an elixir exercise later on in the class, but for the most part, we're going to be dealing with object-oriented programming. One's not really better than the other. People kind of get in this camp of really preferring functional languages or really preferring object-oriented languages, but some problems lend themselves more naturally to one approach or another. For the most part, though, just know that this thing called functional programming exists, and for the most part, that's not what we're doing in this class. So let me talk a little bit about variables in here, I'll pop up to JS Fiddle for another example. I think I will. This might actually be my same example. This is kind of my same example. I don't know that I have that much more to say about this one, except that I'm doing one thing differently in here. That's just using that inner HTML in a slightly different way. I talked about that being on the document object model. I have this paragraph, and the P tag is how you define a paragraph in HTML. But I'm doing something just a little bit different with this P tag. I'm giving it an ID. I really like foo. Foobar, although F-U-B-A-R is... messed up beyond all recognition. I'll let you substitute the F. So foo and bar are kind of common terms to use for naming variables in a lot of places. It's programmer humor, I guess. The ID foo here is what I'm then using in a variable. And uh, So this is the way you do a comment in JavaScript. These two slashes mean that right now I'm not executing this line, var my text equals hello. I'm commenting it out. And that means that nothing is really happening with that. If I uncomment that, you'll see it change color. So now it's nicely colored, and I know it's actually going to be run. And let me run this again. See that hello there? Yeah. That hello is there because there's now a variable that has something in it. Once I have a variable with something in it, that next line here, document.getElementById foo, remember this is called foo, the inner HTML of that object gets set to that variable. So this is a way that we'd seen before that you can go from the JavaScript or from the HTML to the JavaScript by getting the value of this text box. You can also go the other way. You can go from the JavaScript to the HTML by setting this inner HTML from within the document. You'll get really familiar with a lot of these. I'm just kind of giving you a hint of how to read some of this code and how to look through some of the JavaScript that's in here. Buttons, this slide was only here to describe that there's always many ways to do things in JavaScript and HTML. These are just two different ways of defining a button that have different characteristics. The one that I use causes a page refresh, means the whole page loads from the server. There's another way of declaring a button that is a client-side action only, but it has some restrictions that you can't use in earlier versions of some browsers. So before I leave this briefest introduction to JavaScript, and we will come back to this many, many times, the homework this week just says write some JavaScript, and that some JavaScript could just be declaring a variable. I'm not asking you to do anything specific in JavaScript. Are there any questions about fundamentally what a programming language is or what JavaScript is? Anything, Berna? No?
What I wouldn't mind, and I hope they'd mind, that you've got links and things like that.
Yeah, yeah, and we'll go into much more depth about the tutorials and how to write JavaScript code and different problems you run into in JavaScript. Well, you kind of are.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. You really kind of are. Yeah. The only difference between JavaScript or any programming language and Greek is that Greek is a much less defined language in some sense. You have much more linguistic flexibility in a natural human-to-human language. In a human-to-computer language, you have a much tighter set of constraints and a much tighter set of things it can do, which is both good and bad. It is good in the sense that there's much less to learn because it is tightly constrained. It's bad in the sense that if you try and say something that is not in an idiomatic fashion, that is not in the way that the computer is expecting it, it will just break. And so this means that we can spend 12 weeks on learning JavaScript, whereas if we spent 12 weeks learning Greek, we'd still know how to say hello and maybe not much else. So the next thing I'm going to jump into here is actually a chain of slides talking about the web server.
Blueprint and then JavaScript would kind of be like the kind of like fancier stuff, like what color like should this be and like that. I'm just wondering.
Not entirely. There's an element of that. But what color it should be and stuff is actually CSS or cascading style sheets, and we'll be talking about them a little bit towards the end of today. You can think of HTML being putting the text on the screen, putting the buttons on the screen, putting the objects you're going to work with on the screen. Cascading style sheets being how does that look? Does it render narrow like on a phone? Does it render big like on a desktop? What color does it go? And the JavaScript being how does it act? Okay. And the JavaScript is what relates a button to a field on the page. The JavaScript will go to the server and hit a database. The JavaScript are all the intelligent behaviors that underlie that web page and avoid making it work.
So in JavaScript is the only programming language that we're talking about right now.
That's right. Of the three that I mentioned, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, JavaScript is the only programming language. The others are what are called domain-specific languages, really they're just formatting languages in the case of CSS or semantic languages in the case of HTML. Yep. So I sent y'all a link today to a username and a password for the web server. This sound familiar to everybody? It should be sitting in your email. If not, get lots of guesses. Okay, good. I didn't give any instructions as to what one was supposed to do with that information, though. But last time I taught this course, I kind of left people on their own as to where they were going to host their web pages. So some people hosted them up on GitHub Pages. Some people hosted them up on Microsoft Azure, on IBM Bluemix. People put them all over the place. And it was really kind of a mess because nobody kind of understood what the other groups were saying because they'd chosen a different hosting decision. In reality, there are lots and lots of places you can put your web pages. And we'll talk later in the course about some of those places and some of the trade-offs. But I decided it was going to be easier if your projects were all in the same place. And got Compute Canada to build a web server for us. We're doing some research with them, and so they decided to stand up another web server for us. And all of your projects are going to be on that web server. So I've gotten each of you a different virtual root on that web server. What a virtual root is a web server think of it as the base place that messages come in. When I say send me a web page, that's where your message will go. And then the virtual root is what comes after that. So in this picture on the screen, cspublic.uvic.ca, that's the name of the web server that is built for this class. And then this tilde dev00 is the first developer account on this web server. The tilde means go to the home directory for dev00. And then I've gone into the test repo. This was just a little simple repository that I made last class. And to file.html, which was the first thing in that repository. And so I'll click on that, it's going to just say hello. This was the stupidest web page in the world that I made, if you remember, that was just a HTML tag, a body tag, the phrase hello, and then closing the body in the HTML. So there's nothing really about this a web page that's interesting, except for the fact that the server is serving it up now. And so it's not just on my machine, it's where all of you, if you click that link from your machine, could get to it as well. And that's fundamentally all a web server is a central point to serve up web pages. There's a lot more we'll be talking about how it serves those up and how you configure it and everything. But at its most basic, it's just a computer that's on the internet somewhere that everybody can get to that has your web page on it. And so if I come back here, I want to talk to you about how to get that page there now. And this next series of slides is one that I'm absolutely certain you'll have to go back and reference as you do this week's homework. Just kind of watch, and then we'll go through any questions during the break and go through it again. But remember how painful it was setting Git up and doing your first Git operations? This is right in that same category, that we've got Git, and now we've got SSH. What SSH is, Secure Scripting Host, it's called, is a protocol that allows you to talk to a remote server and open up a bash terminal on that remote server. So when we installed Git, we got to Git bash, and then all the ls command and cd and git pull and all the things we've been doing within that bash shell, you can do exactly those same things on the web server. And that's why it was convincing me to try and do things within the typed command shell rather than using the GraphQL user interface. Because when you're talking to your web server, you don't have a GraphQL user interface. All you have is the command window. So you'll see a lot of parallels between using Git and using SSH. But there are some different commands here as well. I actually use an SSH client. And I have this page here just to kind of mention it. When I open up a new connection to the server, let me show you what it looks like. Except I have far too many windows open, and you can't see my screen anyways. So let me drag this over. I use an SSH client called Kitty. TTY or teletext interface? Y doesn't work for interface. I forget what TTY stands for. Early in the teletype, that's right. So early in computing days, you didn't even have a screen. You used a teletype machine, so it printed up on pages. And that TTY standard has actually made its way through to today in a command window, which isn't that different than just text typing up on a printer and a teletype machine. Kitty is a variant of a TTY terminal program. PuTTY is a different one. The only reason that I like using a terminal program for this is that I can set up all the characteristics, the way it looks, the way it connects once, and then I just have to click on it to open. I'm going to click on the dev00, it's going to, on the other screen, of course, open me a terminal that logs in automatically, and then here I'm actually on the remote server machine. So go look at that if you want to make it easier and install a terminal to do some of this. On Macs, you can do that directly, I'm going to show you the way through the Git Bash shell, and it's a little bit less convenient, but it'll give you the commands that you need to know to do this from within the same place you've been doing all the Git commands. So I'm going to close that. And I'm going to open Git Bash. At least I think I'm going to open Git Bash. There we go. Okay. So you're all familiar with this one. Let me go ahead and go into my repo directory and test repo show you what's there, just like it always has been. You are starting to get familiar with how to navigate this, but a little bit of a difference when we go. You do not have outdated or missing Windows drivers. You have something that's trying to sell you something.
Yes, I do.
Never believe those. So here's the picture of what my opened command session said. The first command in the Git shell to type in is this SSH command. You all have SSH as part of Git Bash. In here, just type that again. It's going to be the same one as the start one there. SSH dev00 @. This is saying my username at the server. So I could type in 206.12.96.242. That's the IP address of the server. I could also type this in as cspublic.uvic.ca. Remind me why I can do both of those? DNS? DNS server? All the way back from the first class, the IP address is never going to change on this, but the short name cspublic.uvic.ca is what's resolved by the DNS server to that IP address. So you can use either one of these and they mean the same thing. Then it's going to ask for my password, because I've already said with the dev00 @cspublic.uvic.ca what it is that I'm connecting as. This is the username. It doesn't have to ask for a username. It's just asking for a password. And that's where you're going to paste in that thing I sent you an email. Let me do the same of copying that. And then over here, I will paste that. And then hit enter. That's right, exactly. And then the password that's in there. So you'll substitute your dev number and your password for what I just typed in here. And the first thing, the first time through, it's going to ask you, saying the authenticity of host 206.12.96.242 can't be established. Do you want to continue? What this is saying is the first time you connect to any server, it doesn't know that server. It's kind of asking, are you sure? Did you type this right? Is this where you mean to be connecting? Then it's going to store a fingerprint of that server. The reason it does this is that if anybody in between you does a spoofing attack, tries to hack to make it appear that it's your server, and it's got a different fingerprint, then SSH is going to warn you and go, you might not actually be talking to the computer you think you're talking to. This is important in systems you want to keep secure because you're then typing your password and it could scoop up your password if you're talking to a different system in the middle there. In reality, you'll never hit that with this class, and I don't actually care about the security of your passwords on this that much anyways. Somebody gets non-root access to a web server shell, so what? So don't worry too much about security, but that's why it's asking the question the first time through and why you have to answer yes. The next thing that you'll see in here after you load that is just a command prompt. So let's do an ls and see what's under that command prompt. And we'll see public.html. Public.html is what is known as the virtual root for this web server for your dev account. So this is dev00's virtual root. And whenever I, in the browser, type in that path, like cspublic uvic ca tilde dev00, that's where it's going to go to. It's whatever is inside public HTML. Now let me go inside public HTML. And you'll see I already have a file and a test repo. I'm going to just delete that test repo directory. Incidentally, be very careful with this command. I'm saying remove rm, and then I'm saying minus rf, which means recursively go down everything underneath this and remove it too. And the f means force it. So don't ask me, are you sure, or anything else. Just get rid of it. And if you do this command from the top level of your tree, you're hooped. You can actually erase everything on your hard drive very easily by doing that. So be very, very careful when you force this remove command to only do it when you mean to do it. In this case, I know I want to get rid of test repo and everything underneath it, so I'm going to go ahead and delete it. And it's gone. And then what I'm going to do to recreate it, because I wanted to point to my GitHub repository, let me go find a GitHub repository address to grab for that. Sorry, I think I have that open over here, actually. Let me drag that over. So this is going to be very, very similar to the way that we've been cloning things to your local machine when you begin to work on them inside the Git Bash shell. The only difference here is that instead of cloning to your local machine, I'm cloning up to the web server. And so if I look at the test repo here, I'm going to see that I've got the clone or download address. I'm going to copy that clone or download address. And then I'm going to go back to my command window and say git clone and paste in that address. This all look familiar? Same way we got the repos down to your local machine a while ago? And it's going to go ahead and clone into test repo. I've got test repo back in here. I'm going to go inside test repo. And I can see it's got all the files that I can point to. So that's how I'm actually getting things up to the web server, okay, in order to have them served up from the central machine that's not my laptop, that anybody can get to it regardless of when they're trying to. The way I'm going to encourage you to work with this is not to edit things on the server. If there was something that I wanted to change, let's say I wanted to change that hello to a goodbye, the way I would do it is by going to my local machine, let's do this right now. I'm in test repo on my local machine. See, I've got the same things there. If I do a git status, I'm up to date, clean, nothing to commit. So I'm at exactly the same state as the GitHub server for test repo. And now I'm going to edit something on there. Let's say code dot. And that's going to bring up a Visual Studio Code window with everything in that directory. Let me drag that over to where you can see it. And let's say in file, instead of saying hello in here, I'm going to say goodbye in there. And then I'll save that. If I come back out to here and say git status, see, I've modified file.html, and so I'm to add that to my commit list. and now it's been added to the commit. It's green rather than red. Now I'm going to commit, give that a message, call it goodbye. Now it's saying that I meant status. Now it's going to say that my local branch is one commit ahead of the master branch on GitHub, and I want that to push up to GitHub, so I'm going to git push. That'll go up to git, and now I'm going to pause for a second and show you, just to make sure you believe it, that my file still says hello, because that's what's up on the server. But now if I go into, and this again is dev00 on the server, and if I go into test repo here and say git pull, it's going to update file.html, and now we'll update, and it says goodbye. So that's the whole route that you're going to follow whenever you're making edits to your web page, is to edit them locally. And if I'd wanted to locally, I could also have opened that up in a web browser on my local machine. And so usually I do that and test it on my local machine, and when it looks just like I want it to, I then push it up to GitHub. GitHub is now the central repository of everything I want my web page to be, and then I pull it down to the web server so it's showable to the rest of the world. Does that workflow make sense to everyone? Or at least conceptually make sense to everyone? Let me ask differently. Is there anything specifically about that workflow that confuses anyone?
The whole thing.
Okay. No, that's a fair statement. It's a way of working that has a few conceptual leaps in there.
I haven't made that leap yet.
Yeah.
I'm sure it will in the future.
Okay.
I'm dogged enough that I'll get there.
Cool. Well, I'm going to keep dogging on it and keep pushing you guys on it, and eventually it'll just make perfect sense. That's the way you build websites.
It's just so different from the way I was taught before. We've never used GitHub for that.
Yeah.
So you'd be working on your computer on your HTML and Java, and then like having obviously like a window up in your browser, and then once you've done all your changes, then you do that process.
That's right, exactly. And I usually batch them up. The reason that you have multiple files added in a commit is that I might work on 20 or 30 files and change 20 or 30 things and add them all to the commit message at once and push them all up at once. And so working locally is a much more efficient way to do it. And then you bundle all the changes up at the same time.
So technically, you really need to
only do
one at the end of the year.
Well, once per time you want to stop. I mean, if you're closing your computer and taking it on a bus, go ahead and push before you close your computer and take it on a bus, because who knows if it gets off the bus with you. Exactly. Add good convenient breaking points or good logical breaking points. I often find that when I'm working on a website, I'm working on the authentication page for a couple hours, then I want to go change something on the customer contacts page. So I'll push the authentication up and go work on customer contacts. Anytime you're at a place where you might want to come back to that point.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. It's actually that link at the top there, cspubble.uvic.ca. If you SSH to your dev number at cspubble.uvic.ca. Yep, and you say yes. This is the part I was saying where the first time you connect is not sure what you're connecting to, so it's going to confirm that you have to pay the sun to your
awesome.
Okay, I would normally after that spot have suggested taking a break for a couple of minutes. Unfortunately, we're enough behind schedule that I'm afraid that the homework will make no sense whatsoever unless I forge bravely ahead. People okay with me forging bravely ahead? There will be lots and lots of Slack questions this week. I can tell right now. Please feel free to hit up Slack, and I'm happy to do video chats with anybody who's horribly confused, and we'll get through this stuff. Yeah, so that's just the detail of what I was doing, and that's the page actually you were probably after, but you've gotten past that point now. Bash shell and remote server. Eventually, we'll do other things. We'll move files up and down from this bash shell. We'll install and build your web page when we get to pages that require that. But the first part, cloning your web page, is all I really want you to get to for today. This is just more detail of what I've gone through, and so it's just for when you go back and reference and try and do this yourself that you'll want that. Same thing here. I'm torn between wanting you to take 5 minutes and try doing this and running into lots of problems and having me help with them, or to fly through a little bit of cascading style sheet stuff and then have you try that exercise. I think I'm going to go with the latter and fly through a little bit of cascading style sheet and then do the exercises on things. So cascading style sheets are basically just styling on top of HTML. Everything will generally run without the cascading style sheets. It'll just look uglier than heck. So one of the things that actually you should try as you're working on your HTML page is just to pull the style sheets out and make sure that everything still works. And that if you have a dependency on something in your style sheet, you probably have something in there that that shouldn't be. Yeah. I'll ignore the last bit of this I copied from last term's page, and don't worry about less and sass and CSS variants, and just pretend that paragraph's not there. I'll go quickly by. There are three ways in CSS style sheets that you can select something. The way a style sheet works, and the reason it's a cascading style sheet, is you can have multiple of these style sheets that sit over top of each other and affect the way that your page displays. The three ways you have of talking about something, and here's the order of cascade, is you can select by tag. So for instance, in that example, I had a paragraph tag. I can say all paragraph tags are center aligned, which is what this text align center means. I can select by class, which means that if I give something a class name, and I've got 20 different paragraph tags that are class name 1 and 20 different paragraph tags that are class name 2, then I'm selecting a group of the first 20 paragraph tags by class. And again, I can say that something like the font size is 30 pixels of that first class of paragraph tag. Or remember how I called that one paragraph tag ID equals foo in the JavaScript example at the start of class? That's just a single tag, and I can select by a single tag. And so basically the rules of cascading in CSS files are that more specific trumps more general. And so if I did it by a pound ID, that's going to always apply. If I did it by the tag, that's only going to apply if there's not a class definition or an ID definition that pertains to that object that I'm trying to style. So more specific always wins, and that's why it's a cascading style sheet. I think that's what I just said. So I'm going to actually walk through this first exercise of make I'm a paragraph green and 40 pixels high. And then I'm going to give you guys a minute load the others and try making one blue and another more text button red. And then we'll talk about the answers. So let me do the first one. I've just clicked on that link, and it will someday come up, I hope. Where'd my link go? No? Huh. My link doesn't like me. Oh, there it is. Okay, cool. Okay, so in this first one, I am trying to make, I'm a paragraph, green and 40 pixels high. So let's look at I'm a paragraph. I've got a few things that I could do here. I could do it by the paragraph tag, but I'm going to go as specific as possible and just change this one. Remember when I was a minute ago saying the ways of selecting the most specific is pound ID and then putting something in here? And so let's follow that and say pound para, and then open a curly bracket and say color, spelled the silly American way. Was it blue I was supposed to turn it?
Green.
Green. Thank you. Green. And let's just leave it at that for a minute and run it. Yay, I have a green paragraph. If I wanted to then turn it to font size 40 pixels and run it, and I have a big green paragraph. So you see how I can select specific items and style them from within my CSS file? Why don't you guys go ahead and try and turn the other what was I supposed to do? I was supposed to make another paragraph blue and more text in the button red. And I'll leave that up there for you to follow as an example. I'm going to grab a drink. I'll be right back. Okay, who's stuck? Who has questions? It is not actually, that's a class rather than an ID. And I remember the slide I was on the screen was in the free way of the slide. So the pound that will create an ID. The pound is the ID, like you're using here, of the document class. Everybody getting along okay?
So you're not picky about it being like formatted, but you know, sort of written like that instead of one line and stuff.
No, it's really not very big. As long as there's semicolons separating them. So remember I was talking about how you reference IDs versus classes, that you use the pound sign for pound star to reference that in the top, is how you reference all that. So I would want to talk to Mark.
And that's what it looks like.
And this is because the class name is Mark. So you're trying to select the class name.
Yeah.
Is there joy and happiness around the room, or you need another minute? Some joy and happiness? Okay, great. I see sufficient joy and happiness. I'm going to go ahead and push on. So let's look at the solution just for completeness sake, make sure everybody's on the same page here, that when we were selecting the first one, it was by ID, and we stuck the font size and the color in there. The second one, I decided to select all paragraph tags rather than by ID, and did that specifically because I was showing that cascading nature here, that if I hadn't had the other two rules here, then all of the paragraphs would have been blue. But because the more specific trumps the less specific, this only affected the center paragraph. And then the last one I did by class with dot bar, so anything of class bar would have been affected with that one. Is that about what everybody else got? Yep, that would have done it too. Okay, so, oops, sorry.
Can I just look at that one? Oh, I see.
Yep.
There's more of this hidden.
Okay. Oh, yes, sorry. Yeah, I had it stretched that.
That's fine.
Oh, see, look, you stretched my camera. Cool. Okay. The next thing I want to talk about a CSS system called Flexbox. I'm actually kind of in love with Flexbox. It made a lot of the positioning problems that CSS had just really go away. It's only supported in more recent browsers. One of the reasons that I pull up this chart is that if you're on an old machine with an old browser and Flexbox just isn't working, come back and look at this chart and then decide, I don't care if somebody on IE9 can't read my stupid web page. They should update their browser. Really, if for this class you're only working on modern browsers, working on the latest stuff, I'm just fine with that. At some point in your web development career, you may have to, unfortunately, worry about an old browser, but this class is not it. Everywhere in here, Flexbox will work wonderfully. And one of the reasons I like Flexbox is that there is a really fun game to play with Flexbox. And I might actually suggest that you guys take just a couple minutes to play a couple minutes of Flexbox Froggy. What Flexbox Froggy is you've got a set of lily pads that the game puts up for you, and you've got some frogs, and you're going to be using CSS commands to position those frogs onto those lily pads. So for instance, on this first one, I've got this command called justify content, and if I hover over justify content, it's going to tell me all the things that can go with that: flex start, flex in, center, space between, space around. And I've got this idea of where the frame is that I'm using. So flex start is to the left-hand side, flex end is to the right-hand side, flex bottom or space bottom equal spacing between things, center puts it in the center. And so to get this frog onto this lily pad, I'm going to use the justify content. Oops, if I spell it right. Content flex end. And then I'll press next. And the froggy is on the lily pad. And he jumps away happily off, and it gives me the next problem. So why don't you all go play a couple minutes of Flexbox Froggy to learn about some of these Flexbox commands, and only get to a level 3 or 4 maybe to get an idea of what Flexbox is. Yes, I'm on problem 2 now.
be teaching kids in school?
I think we are currently.
Level 5 just threw a wrench into the works.
Uh-oh. Yeah, it gets tougher as you go on. You find a sticker there?
I thought it was doing okay, and then another wrench.
Yeah, yeah, it just tripped me. It's fun.
I get it. I was putting all in the scene. You know what?
So I think you guys get the idea of Flexbox Froggy. I'd really encourage you to finish playing Flexbox Froggy at home. It is a really good game to learn some Flexbox in. But let's keep forging bravely ahead and spend some time working on the problem of getting your web server set up as well. And get those two pieces done, and I think the homework's going to be a slam dunk this week. To play Froggy. So what I'd like to do is just describe this week's homework, see if you have any questions on that, and then we can jump back to that server setup where you're pushing your GitHub code up to your server. I want to have a chance to give people any help on that they may need to get their code pushed up properly. Then with those pieces, if you can push your code up properly, you can build a simple CSS or even one using Flexbox, like with Flexbox Froggy commands, in the tiniest way some JavaScript, even if it's a variable that says console log hello within script tags, I put some JavaScript in there, then you've got all the pieces you need to get this week's homework done. And this week's homework doesn't really have to do anything. I don't tell you what type of web page to build or anything. All I want to know is that you have the mechanical steps of how do I include a CSS file, how do I include a JavaScript file, how do I position things and get it up to the server. And then after we have those mechanical steps of how do I get something on the server rendering, then we can go to town on making it pretty, making it functional, making it do all the things we want to do. But we're still in the process of mechanical steps with this one. thoughts or questions on this week's homework? Yeah.
Well, we make any repositories, do we always have to have a README file?
I tend to. The reason I usually have a README file is because it means that when I do the git clone step, it actually brings something down. If you try and clone an empty directory, it doesn't really work very well. It throws an error in most versions of Git. And so the README serves two roles. It means you can clone down properly. It also is just good practice to have a README that says, what the heck is this project supposed to be? Because I guarantee you in 6 months when you come back and look at a repo named HW4, you're going to go, what was I doing here? So I often, in things like this, would actually just copy from the slide the text of the homework 4 and paste that into the README so I have a reminder of what the task was. Cool. So I suspect that most of you have not actually logged into your server and tried pushing something up to your server. So that's what I would suggest working on in the few minutes you've got me around in person to help with things. If you want it gone forever from your repository, you can delete it there as well. But on your local machine, just delete it. Not at all. It's still on the server. That repository is still on the server. But because you don't have anything pushed up there, I think we're going to change the server. Okay. So conceptually, do you understand kind of the role that Git is playing in this? Kind of like volatility, yeah, with the exception that we have this three-stage process to push things into it. Stage number one is after you've modified your files, you have a difference between your local machine and the server machine. That you add the file, and so the git add command is saying all of the files that I've touched, and there might have been 20 or 30 of them set of changes, make sure they're added to the same commit. I can think of that So the essential Git commands here, if you create a directory,
No, actually,
daily mails.
So that is now brought the did you install the so I would then edit and so code this what I'm saying and then launch
yes.
And I usually get
Install.
So yeah, I agree.
So, hold on a second. Install code command in path. Command shift or control shift. Install code. Oh, shell command install code. I will send you the link. The main thing that was doing is aligning the modules to your code from the direct let me bounce around and tell you the question. Once your SSH is in, you're all over the system. So this is really having to buy back to the system. So you're trying to come along. You have pulled down you're inside the public, you've got a web business landing one.
Okay, so you want to plan that HTML. And so up here, you would be you're taking out the HTML there. And so the slide, you're going to take out the
period. Think about it.
Here's the horrible project with and unfortunately, it doesn't auto complete for you in this case. You also learn not to do repo names, the horrible, horrible long names. And then the plan that he came on. Okay, so I don't know what happened, but it is now resolved. Good, that's what I was hoping.
I just have a question. So I created a new spot for query for the home report, and I cloned it and everything like that.
Yep.
But now I'm in this public thing. So am I just trying to create it and push it?
Well, kind of. So if you do an ls there, you'll see that there's this homework 4 in my repo. And so if you cd into homework 4, you should see whatever you had in homework 4. Do an ls in that. Okay, so you have a readme and that's all. And so I would go ahead and on your local machine work on homework 4 and then do it all on the website. And do it all the way you want. Do the get add, get commit, get push.
Oh, okay.
And then from here you'll just say get pull.
Get pull. Oh, like you did another thing. And then pull will.
The pull will pull everything down from the GitHub server into this directory on the web server.
Okay, cool. Okay, I can do that. Okay,
cool.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Cheers.
All right. I'm sorry.
Okay, thanks. The web server is the thing on a piece of infrastructure that is not your laptop that is serving up the web pages.
Okay.
And so this is sitting in the UVic data center and is where you're putting HTML files for the rest of the world.
How do
we
do that?
That's what I'm saying. But you can go over to your
Here?
Yeah, that's the link to my test repo on the web server. And so when you, what was your DAP number when I sent you the credentials?
It is
125. Great. So you will be seeing yours under tilde. You'll see yours under underscore dev 25. And what are the name of your repository and your HTML file? Well, but you won't have anything up there yet.
Oh, I see. So
because this is what you have to go through all the steps to get create the repository and log into the web server and then clone it from your repository to that web server.
Okay, so that already. So
does that make sense?
Well, it kind of did. So basically. I'll go through it.
Do you want to work on that for a couple minutes while I help with your initial problem, and then I'll come back and check to see if you've got any
questions? Okay.
Let me pull mine over there.